Okay, thank you. And thank you for inviting me to come here and talk about the fish fauna in the Barents Sea. Managed to get this to work. Yes. So the polar seas is the Antarctic seas with the seas, the Antarctic continent with the seas around it, whereas the Arctic is the polar basin with its marginal shelf seas. And of these, the Barents Sea is the largest. It's 1.1 million square kilometers. For you Swedish people, it's four times as big as the Baltic. It's a large area. The way I structure this talk is to give some background information on the oceanography and fishery, then talk about species composition and spatial distributions, and some recent changes. Oi. So, what happened? Okay. The Barents Sea, the whole of the Barents Sea is Arctic. If you use Arctic with a capital A, that means it refers to a geographic area because it's at a high latitude and the whole of the shelf is north of the polar circle with very pronounced seasonality and light conditions with midnight sun and polar nights. But there is some kind of duality to the Barents Sea. So if you use Arctic with a small a as a descriptor, it's only the northern or northeastern part of the Barents Sea is truly Arctic, because that area is covered with ice during winter. So this map shows the month of ice, the month with ice in the Barents Sea, annual averages from 2007 until 2011. And you can tell that it's only covered with ice parts of the year, only during winter. So in the northeastern Barents Sea, has winter ice, and that is continues with the polar ice cap. And it has sub-zero low salinity waters, so it's a cold pool that forms also. It's part of the Arctic Barents Sea. And it has a certain Arctic biota that is adapted to the conditions. The other kind of extreme of the Barents Sea is the south-southwestern part. This part is Atlantic, it's dominated by inflow from the Atlantic Ocean. It's the Gulf Stream with temperate water, saline, yeah, with high salinity. And the Atlantic current branches here. So part of it runs along the shelf to the west and the north of the Barents Sea shelf, whereas one branch runs through the Barents Sea, like a river flowing through it. And this part cools down within the Barents Sea. And this is the main transportation of heat into the Arctic region. And the branch that goes through the Barents Sea cools down, so that brings colder water into the Barents Sea compared to the branch going along the shelf. And the relative strength of these two branches varies with the weather pattern within the Barents Sea. So the Barents Sea is important for heat transport into the Arctic region. The Barents Sea is an important fishing ground. These are landings in the Norwegian and Barents Sea. The Norwegian Sea is the basin that's west and southwest of the Barents Sea. So this is the most, it's from 1965 until now. It's nine species listed here, but it's dominated by red capelin, black herring, and blue Atlantic cod. And all of these species spend at least part of their life cycle within the Barents Sea. The fishing in the Barents Sea used to be coastal. This picture is taken more than 100 years ago in the Lofoten area, which is in the north coast of Norway. And that's the main spawning ground of Barents Sea cod. And here there's been a traditional fishery for centuries. But now the Barents Sea is fished almost all over the shelf. This is the fishing activity in 2015. Russian and Norwegian vessels, and the different colors on the map refer to different gears. The fishes that is dominant in the Barents Sea, the fishery in the Barents Sea is also important for global capture. This is from a FAO report ranking the different marine capture species by their importance in terms of biomass. And Atlantic herring is the fifth, was the fifth in this table. And the world's largest stock of herring, it's the Norwegian spring spawning herring, and it, the juveniles of these stocks grow up in the Barents Sea. Number 11 is Atlantic cod. The Barents Sea cod stock is the largest in the world, and 75% of the global catches is from the Barents Sea stock. On 13th place is capelin. It's a key species in the Barents Sea, but currently the catches is mainly from the Icelandic stock. And this is updated. It was updated in 2016, and then capelin has dropped out of this list. So herring and cod, they are temperate water boreal species. And both of these species spawn along the coast of Norway, cod mainly in the Lofoten area, herring further south along the coast of western Norway. And this Atlantic current is not only important for transporting heat into the Barents Sea, it's also transport fry and larvae of herring, cod and other species spawning along the coast of Norway. And it also transport their food copepods, Calanus firmarchicus. And the Barents Sea cod, it returns to the Barents Sea after spawning, so they spend only, the mature cod spend their spawning in spring in the coast of Norway, and then they spend the rest of the year within the Barents Sea together with the immature cod. Whereas the herring, they spend the first 3 to 5 years of their life within the Barents Sea, and then when they mature, they start using the Norwegian Sea as their feeding ground. The capelin is more of an arctoboreal species. It's spawn along the north coast of Russia and Norway. And it has its whole life cycle within the Barents Sea, and it dies after spawning when it's 3 to 5 years of age. And these are pelagic species feeding on plankton, whereas this is it's plankton when it's small, then it eats more and more fish, and it's the most important piscivore in the Barents Sea. So these species interact, and for harvested species, it's, they can be affected by climate, trophic interactions, and of course by harvesting. It's rarely a question of only one factor contributed to stock fluctuations, but more a question of their relative importance. But the herring collapsed in the late 1960s. So you can see the lot of the black is kind of disappearing for a while here. And it's generally agreed that this was due to overfishing. When the herring collapsed, the capelin fishery developed, as you can see on the red there, until the capelin collapsed. And that is more kind of controversial why that happened, but the fishing pressure was really high. But also, this first collapse coincided with a recruitment failure. And herring, juvenile herring, can prey on capelin larvae. And this first collapse there happened when there was a strong cohort, a strong year class of capelin, no, herring entering into the Barents Sea. There have been two other collapses, one in the 90s and one in the early 2000s. And after the first collapse, the fishery was much more strongly regulated. So fishery is not causing this. But this also coincided with two strong year classes of herring coming into the Barents Sea. Currently, there are no ongoing collapse. And now we think maybe cod predation is involved because the cod stock is really large. And cod has really efficiently preyed on capelin, but capelin can sustain a very high predation pressure when the recruitment is good. And the recruitment was good until 2014 when there was a recruitment failure. But that didn't coincide with a strong year class of herring, so we don't know why that happened. Yeah. The cod was at a historic low in the mid-80s. And that's due to high fishing pressure. But also the capelin collapse contributed to this, because cod was feeding almost exclusively on capelin at this period. And then when the capelin collapsed, the individual growth of of cod plummeted, and the weight at age for some age classes was halved, and then because the quota is given in biomass and not in individuals, that kind of contributed to the effect of fishery. So, yeah. So because the Barents Sea is so important, the stocks in the Barents Sea is so important for Norway and also northern Russia, it's been a lot of monitoring and research going on for a long, very long period. This map was drawn in 1878 by Georg Sage, a pioneer marine biologist from Norway. And it shows the cod migration, because already more than 100 years ago, they knew that the fish spawning along the coast of Norway lived their life within the Barents Sea, because they tagged individuals and recaptured them up at the Svalbard area. So we've written the Skrei district. Skrei is mature Barents Sea cod, so that's the Lofoten area. And then it's the Lodde district, that's the capelin district, that's where capelin spawn. And then he draw the capelin cod migration, because capelin migrates to the coast to spawn, and then it's followed by immature cod. And so that in Finnmark County, Norway, is also a traditional fishery for cod. And he has his own. He has his own boat. The biggest boat we had at the Institute at Marine Research is named after Georg Sage. This is another pioneer, Johan Hjort, and he has his own boat. And so research has been going on for a long time. I just have to drink some water. But area surveys, when you have a survey design with cruise lines and acoustics and so on, that started in the 70s when the quota system was implemented. And that was done to support quota advice. And it has a single stock perspective. But now we have an ecosystem-based approach to fisheries management. And in 2004, we started an ecosystem survey, which is a cooperation between IMR in Norway and PINRO, our sister institute in Murmansk, Russia. So this is the Barents Sea again. So the eastern part, it's part of the Russian exclusive economic zone. So we have a... managed to see if this works. What is this? Oh. Never mind. The Novaya Zemlya is that big archipelago that delimits the Barents Sea to the Kara Sea in the east. So that belongs to Russia. And then the western part of the Barents Sea, the southwestern part, is part of the Norwegian exclusive economic zone. And then you have the area around the Svalbard archipelago in the north, northwest. And that's a fishery protection zone. It's under Norwegian legislation, but that's disputed. So we cover the whole shelf with 4 to 5 vessels every year. So this is a very comprehensive survey. It's the biggest survey in the Barents Sea, and it's run in August, September, when the Barents Sea shelf is ice-free. So that's the cruise lines in 2013. And it's not only comprehensive because it covered a large area, but we also measure temperature with CTD probes, plankton, zero group fish with pelagic holes, acoustic for pelagic fish, bottom trawl samples of demersal fish and benthic invertebrates. We have seabirds observations and marine mammal observation. So we can look at distributions and interactions. I talked about capelin, cod and herring, but there are of course more fish in the sea. But the question is how many, and that is remarkably difficult to answer, even for such a well-researched area as the Barents Sea. Why is this so difficult? Well, it's not so easy to determine or identify fish, and these are fishery surveys, and not everybody going there are trained taxonomists. So we have misidentifications. That's something we work on, but still. Then we have taxonomic uncertainty, and that's that fish up there, that's a snail fish of the genus Caryproctus. And some authors claim it's 24 species of this fish group in the Barents Sea, whereas maybe a new barcoding evidence suggests it's only 3 or 4. So this is also a thing. And then we have how you define the Barents Sea, how far up in the littoral zone and how far down you go on the slope. And then you undersample some habitats and some groups of fish. So maybe 150 to 200 species in the Barents Sea. At the ecosystem survey, when you include pelagic and demersal trawls, we have caught about 117 species from we started in 2004. So who are you? Who are they? When you present yourself, you give your family name, and this is the family name, so there's fishes in the Barents Sea. Most of the, or the most species-rich family is the eel pouts, followed by the liparids. But these are the groups with the most taxonomic uncertainty, so these numbers might be wrong. Then we have the codfish, the sculpins, and the flatfishes. Then we have 11 families with 2 to 4 species, and then there are 24 families with only one species. So what do they do there? Most of them live close to the bottom. They are demersal. Some in the pelagic. Most are omnivore, feeds both on fish, benthic invertebrates, and plankton, like the Atlantic cod. But some of the smaller demersal fishes are benthivore, and also some of the flatfishes. And then most of the pelagic feed mainly on plankton, but there are ontogenetic shifts, like for cod, which is become more and more piscivore, and it's the most important predator on other fish in the Barents Sea. So where are they? I told you about the dual water masses in the Barents Sea, and then this is reflected in the fauna. This is from the ecosystem survey, the demersal trawl stations in 2011. And this is a multivariate kind of correspondent analysis run on the data, fish data. So it shows the species turnover. So the red, big red bullets have a different species composition than the big blue bullets. So the main gradient within the Barents Sea is from southwest to northeast. So it's not often you see from south to north, more here is from southwest to northeast. And that's also the case, it's reflected in the fauna from the benthic invertebrates. It's a very similar pattern. This is another way of a similar type of analysis. So here we have used more years of data and we gridded them and run a cluster analysis to, and so the grid cells with similar species composition have different colors. So we had this same gradient, and this is a temperature gradient. So from turquoise in the northeast, cold to warm in the southwest, the red. But almost as important is the depth gradient. So we have some more oceanic areas, deeper water areas. This upper figure here is the canonical correspondence analyzing, where we have plotted the grid cells according to the main gradients in the environment. So the main gradient is a temperature gradient, but also depth. And the upper part of the graph, the purple, yellow, and red, they are shallow water communities. And the purple one, it's fundamentally around the Novaya Zemlya archipelago, and that consists of coastal cold water fishes, like this one. It's the Arctic staghole sculpin. So when we started to work on the ecosystem survey data, we decided that we would make an atlas of all the fishes we caught, so we made an atlas. So this is the page from this atlas. Yes, so this fish is distributed around the archipelago of Novaya Zemlya, and also around Svalbard area, because in Svalbard there are ice in the fjords, so that's cold, but then you have this Atlantic current running on the shelf. So in the southwest, you have a coastal warm water species. So many fish, they go along the coast of Norway, and they have the northern distribution area in this, just on this area, in this area, like Norway redfish, from the atlas again. This yellow shallow water community is kind of interesting because it's not really characterized by what species it have. It's more characterized by that it lacks species. It's very species poor. And this is from a paper, and we speculate: is this because of trawling activity? Is it because it's homogeneous? Is it because it has low salinity? We don't know. So now I showed you the main distribution patterns during summer, but in the Barents Sea, a lot of the species migrate. So they have different distribution in summer and winter, like the blue whiting. So we also made an atlas based on a winter survey, because it's a winter survey covering the southern part of the Barents Sea, run in February, March every year. So the blue whiting in the Barents Sea is continuous with the blue whiting in the Norwegian Sea, and they have extended feeding migrations into the Barents Sea, especially during summer. This is the Atlantic cod, the distribution of the Atlantic cod. In August, September 2013, where cod reaches all-time, it had a record northward distribution. And you can tell that 6 months later, it's aggregated more in the southern part of the Barents Sea. Whereas some migrate, some stays, like these ones. These are Arctic fishes. They are the second and third most important Arctic or abundant Arctic fish species in the Barents Sea after polar cod. So this is when at the ecosystem survey, we captured them then in the northeastern part. Whereas during the winter survey, we hardly captured them at all, so they are found under the ice during winter. And these species are quite small, they are about this size. And they feed mainly on benthic invertebrates. And this is work done by our colleague in Pindrov Murmansk. Because you have this seasonal migration pattern, you have seasonal variation in interactions between the Arctic and the Atlantic Barents Sea. So we have stronger interactions in the ice-free season. And because the Arctic fishes tend to be small, this is the average length distribution in the northern Barents Sea, they easily fall prey of larger fishes like cod during summer. And there have been some recent changes. This is a map of the global warming from 1960 until today. And it's really in the Barents Sea and the Arctic region where the warming is happening fastest, twice as fast as the global average. But most of this temperature increase actually happened before we started to do the ecosystem survey monitoring. But we've seen some changes since 2004. Here is another analyzer where trawl stations are grouped after species composition of fish. So red is dominated by boreal temperate water species, yellow is a transition zone, and then blue is dominated by Arctic cold water species. And you can tell 9 years later that the area with dominated by Arctic fishes has shrunk, and then transition zone has increased as the area covered by warm water species. And this is not only due to changes in the dominant species. It's even if you remove the dominant species, that pattern that I just told you holds more or less. But it's also apparent in the dominant species, like this one, the polar cod, which is the most abundant Arctic fish in the Barents Sea and in the whole Pan-Arctic region. This is from an atlas that we are under the way. This is a sample page and showing the distribution of polar cod. This is the distribution of polar cod in the Barents Sea. Here's the average distribution from 2004 to 2013. And then this to your right is the change. So it's blue means it's decrease, and red means it's an increase, and the size of the bullets is proportional to the rate of change. So you can see that the polar cod has decreased all over the Barents Sea shelf in this period. There have also been significant declines in other Arctic fishes. We removed the polychaete because it's so dominant and looked at the odd ones. And then we've seen that the number of species per station of Arctic fish and the number of individuals of Arctic species has shown significant declines. And we have a poster on this symposium based on this report that we made. So that's also evident if you look at different species. This is the big-eyed sculpin again. It has had significant change in the area distribution, occupancy, and also abundance. And so also for the gelatinous snailfish, the same reduction in distribution area, occupancy, and abundance. So is this only due to changes in temperature? I think not. I think this Atlantic cod is involved. This shows the average density of cod. It's the same map as I showed for the polychaete. And here you can see it's more red than blue, so the Atlantic cod has increased. There's an overall increase in density, but it's also a northward shift in distribution. And this graph doesn't have axis because I wanted to plot the fishing mortality and the biomass in the same graph. But this is the ecosystem survey period, and the biomass of Atlantic cod has been above the long-term mean in the whole period. But especially it increased around 2007-08. And that's when there was a new harvest control rule of Atlantic cod implemented, and also a reduction in illegal fishery. So you can see the red line go down and the blue line really jumps up. And at this time, there were two very strong cohorts of cod in the Barents Sea, 2004 and 2005 year classes. So they had good conditions. And then when they were entering the fishery, this new management regime was implemented. So instead of them being fished out, they were allowed to grow and dominate the Barents Sea cod stock. So we also looked at the northward expansion, and temperature are not directly responsible for the expansion. It's all down to food. We divided the Barents Sea in different sub-regions, and we saw that where they expand the most, where the occupancy increase, that's where they had most food in their stomach in the beginning of the study in 2004. But over time, the food is depleted. If you look at the northeastern part of the graphs, this is the stomach fullness, and you can see there is a decline in the stomach fullness. So now the stomach fullness in this expansion area is at the same level as the rest of the Barents Sea. So what they've done, they have become much more cod in the Barents Sea, and then they have gone into the north-northeastern part of the Barents Sea where there's a lot of food. And now they had depleted their food there. And what is the food they have there? It's the Arctic fishes and other, of course, species. So this shows the temporal development of Atlantic cod in blue and polar cod in red. So it's a quite strong negative correlation. And you can see that the Atlantic cod increased where the polar cod has decreased. And this is an index of spatial overlap. So the spatial overlap has increased, and we have stomach samples of Atlantic cod, so we can estimate consumption, and you can tell that the consumption in the late 2000 has been quite high and probably contributed to the decline in polar cod. So to sum up, in the Barents Sea, we have fauna consists of two partly separated systems, an Arctic system, with cold water species that are non-commercial. They are mostly small-bodied and mainly feed on benthic invertebrates, like this is an example species, the gelatinous snailfish. And then they have a boreal system with temperate water species, and that it dominated by species that are commercially exploited. And some of them have large bodies and are piscivore, like cod. These two systems are more linked in summer than in winter. And while this part of the system is thriving, these are in decline. caused by direct and indirect effect of warming, and also maybe an indirect effect of fishing, the fishing, the management of the fishing of the Atlantic cod. So thank you for listening.